Okay, thanks for joining us today. For those who don't know me, I'm Darlene McLennan, and I'm the manager of the Australian Disability Clearinghouse on Education and Training, ADCET for short. Today's meeting session or webinar is being live captioned. To access the captions, go to your toolbar, either located at the top or bottom of your screen, to access them there, or we're also putting captions into OneCap, and Jane will put that link into the caption into the chat box now. I want to start by acknowledging that I'm coming to you from Lutjwita, Tasmanian Aboriginal land, sea and waterways, and acknowledge with deep respect the traditional custodians on the land, the Palawa people. I stand for a future that profoundly respects and acknowledges Aboriginal perspective, culture, language and history, and a continued effort to fight for Aboriginal justice and rights, paving a way for a strong future. I would also like to acknowledge the traditional custodians on the various lands on which we are all working or studying today, and any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples that are participating in this session. Today, for a bit of a difference, if people have joined ADCET with our sessions before, we're using the meeting platform instead of the webinar platform. The reason for this is we're going to have some breakout sessions, giving people an opportunity to come together and talk. So hopefully you're aware that today's session is Access Plans for VET Educators. This resource sits on ADCET now. It's a suite of professional learning resources. And our presenters, Jen Cousins and Meredith Jackson, worked collaboratively with disability practitioners and educators from across the sector, including people from TAFE Queensland, TAS-TAFE, TAFE New South Wales, Charles Darwin University, TAFE Western Australia and TAFE SA. This session will explore the resources and how they can be accessed and how to contextualise them to your audience. I'm really excited about having this session, and I think sometimes we put things on the website and we get a lot of engagement, but to actually hear some of the practical strategies to actually, you know, put it into practice is really wonderful. And also this webinar will be a resource that will sit on that that page on the website as well to help people engage in the content. As I said, we are being captioned. When we go to the breakout rooms, we'll ensure the captioner goes with anybody who needs the captioning. Please message Jane Hawkswood in the chat box if you didn't identify that you need captioning, so we can work that out. Some other housekeeping details. We are recording this, and the recording will go on ADCET in the coming days. If you have any technical difficulties, you can email us at admin@adcet.edu.au. I think the session will go around for 50 minutes. I forgot to confirm that, Jen and Meredith.
Yes, right.
But good. And then we ask people to put any questions into the chat box, and Jen and Meredith will answer those. But feel free to chat with each other and have a conversation throughout the session too. Just make sure you choose all panellists and attendees so we can all see what the conversation is happening with each other. I think people have done that anyway, but just encouraging people to remain mute when they're not talking and to keep their video off just to help with the bandwidth for people joining us as well, because we've had over 85 people register, which is absolutely fantastic. I think even 90 something last count. Okay, I think that's it from me. So over to you, wonderful women. So exciting to see both of your beautiful faces and to have you with us today. So thank you once again on behalf of ADCET and on behalf of me to sharing your knowledge and for doing this work. It's brilliant.
Terrific. Thanks, Darlene, and welcome everybody. In the spirit of reconciliation, Meredith and I also would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the various lands that we're all meeting on today and pay our respects to the elders and to that cultural heritage that we should be incredibly proud of as Australians. Thanks also to the ADCET team for hosting us and hosting the resources that we developed as part of our project. It's great to have this opportunity today to just unpack them a little bit more for everybody and think about some of the ways that they can be used. And I have popped in the chat box there the link to those resources if you haven't already had an opportunity to have a look at those. We started this project in 2019. It came about from a whole range of conversations that we'd had with the VET sector, with the NDCO network and ATTEND and ADCET itself, you know, just in our discussions, recognising that we needed to perhaps bring forward some better VET-based resources and develop perhaps a better connection and network within the VET sector around those things. And in that context, there were lots of discussions going on about the Disability Discrimination Act and the standards for education and how well they were being understood. There's lots of discussion around disclosure as being a requirement, often to get reasonable adjustments and the level of support that students were requiring. And in the VET sector in particular, lots of discussion around the training packages and that they're not always being written in an inclusive way and that because they are actually written in a way that I guess identifies a lot of inherent requirements, that just created some challenges around that. The different funding models we have in each of the states, limited VET guidance and training for people, really just, you know, there were a whole lot of issues just bubbling away. And so the first thing we really wanted to kind of look at was around access plans, because that seemed to be really anecdotally, that's where a lot of the feedback was coming from and saying that, look, it's often people acknowledge that access plans are a process that we use, they understand why we use them, but when they actually reach the educators, that there's real challenges in the way that they're being implemented, the way they're understood, and what the impact really is for the student or the outcome in the way that they're being implemented. And so we were really keen to pursue some of that, and we could see it through other data like surveys that were being done across the VET sector, complaints data, you know, what the students were saying about their experience. And that's where we really came together as a project group to have a look at those sorts of things. And this project, the Access Plan resources, really were a result of those conversations and collaborations.
Thanks, Jen, and thanks, Darlene, and hello, everyone. It's very exciting to have this opportunity to join you and talk about this wonderful project that we were able to get involved with. It really wasn't hard for us to collectively work on the aims that we, you know, we had in regards to this. We all recognised the need to have, you know, a better mechanism of support for our educators from beginning to the more experienced educators, and also some resources and approaches that supported the non-educators as well that work with us, and equally our equity practitioners across our VET sector. So that was really, you know, the start of our aims. It was also a great opportunity to build on existing networks that we have. I mean, you know, as a practitioner, we've got some outstanding networks that we rely on and we nurture. And this was a great opportunity to continue and build further networks for the support and the collegiality that that we needed and that we knew would foster the development of knowledge and skills and confidence with our VET sector. We aimed at promoting this partnership and really showcasing the value in working together and looking at all roles in the VET sector, how, you know, by coming together and collectively, you know, working with each other, we would ultimately be supporting our students. Improving the understanding and awareness of the student and equity services that are provided across our country by all of our VET organisations. It was also an opportunity for us to broaden and deepen the understanding of reasonable adjustments in the VET sector and what our
stakeholder responsibilities were. So those responsibilities by the equity practitioners, those for the educators, and for ultimately for the students as well. And also the aim of the project was to share. We had a great collection of wisdom and experience, and it was a fine time for us to get together and engage in those conversations, and then also get those conversations out there across the sector around the understanding, awareness and implementation of our access plans. Okay, what were we trying to achieve? The correlation between what we were doing as the practitioners, like streamlining what was happening with our educators and also our students, and building our students self-advocacy and confidence and understanding of access plans. We wanted to have an opportunity to really develop our educators. And, you know, I mentioned earlier from the beginning, from the first time that they start in our sector, you're aware we've got some really experienced industry practitioners that come into our educational environment, and they may not have a strong background in access plans and understanding. So this was an opportunity to really build from the ground up, and then also build on those that, are more confident and have a really good understanding, but need some further information to be able to work with the access plans. And we also wanted to look at how we could build the confidence with our teachers in regards to having conversations with our students around access plans, as well as building the student themselves conversations and creating that greater self-advocacy. And also that understanding and awareness of inherent requirements and reasonable adjustments, so that our students will be making more informed choices. Looking at streamlining our organisational processes, we work on national training packages in our VET sector in Australia. It made sense to look at how we could streamline organisational processes and give some really good models to our VET sector as well. And as I mentioned earlier, looking at strengthening the student voice and the self-advocacy. And, when we were looking at really what we were trying to achieve, I know, sort of towards the end of the year when we had our Pathways conference, I can remember Dr. Sheila Daniel-Mays from the Uni of Sydney presenting at Pathways. And what she said really resonated with me at the time. And I really felt it was reflective of what we were doing as this, community of practice and with this project, because she talked about creating places of belonging for people, for those living with disability. And, looking further from the diversity and inclusion that we see in our sector. And I really felt that was what we were doing with this project, and with this national resource that was emerging, was we were ensuring that we were, stepping towards creating a greater sense of belonging for our students, and also ensuring that, we as the practitioners were creating a greater sense of belonging ourselves within the VET context. So that was really exciting, and the passion that emerged from our COP was fantastic. So that's wonderful. So that's what we were looking at achieving.
Thanks, Meredith. I think one of the key things too is around that we didn't really want to keep reinventing the wheel. Like, we need to learn to share, I think, across our sector, and to support each other. And that's been one of the great things about the resource, is that we've come together very collaboratively to develop that. And we had to really kind of work for quite a while to identify exactly what were the types of topics that we wanted to cover in the resource. And I think at the outset, we had a lot of discussion about acknowledging that their educators often don't have training in these particular areas. We don't often talk about access plans in our TAE trainings at the Cert 4 or the diploma levels. And then it's often dealt with as an inclusive sort of design topic, I guess, when you get to the higher education areas. So we often overlook that whole kind of area of reasonable adjustments, inherent requirements, access plans, and the I guess, structures that support that in our organisations. And I think that's really important, that we needed to acknowledge that our educators, you know, just may not have had the opportunity to really get that training previously, and we really wanted to build on the expertise that they already have. So the topics that we cover in the resources is really about, you know, what is an access plan? So people understanding about that as a tool that's used within the VET sector, or I guess the tertiary sector and the school sectors, but how does it actually apply in the VET sector? What kind of framework, legal framework, really supports the use of access plans? And what's the true purpose of it? Because we felt that a lot of the evidence was suggesting that people were really struggling with what, you know, was the actual purpose of the access plan. And a lot of educators were telling us that they felt that the access plan was flagging to them that this person had a disability, that they should know a lot more about that disability, and that equity services, student services, they should really, you know, kind of fix the problem for us, rather than understanding that that access plan was really designed to prompt them in their thinking. And we really wanted to strengthen that understanding of the roles of the equity services with the educators and the student, and seeing that that's a partnership if we're going to be working around an access plan. And we really want to make sure that people get enough information and understanding to understand those roles and responsibilities and feel confident enough around having some of those conversations. And the, I guess, finer details around confidentiality and disclosure, which I think, you know, often is a challenge for people. You know, the access plan is saying, yes, the student has something that requires us to respond, but how much or how little do we need to know? And what is the impact when we're not respectful around that confidentiality and disclosure for the student? Thinking then a little bit around the inherent requirements and the reasonable adjustments, and then what sorts of things can I do from a practical level around implementing access plans and documenting and reviewing those access plans, really from the educator point of view. So what are they actually doing in terms of their documenting the processes and the strategies that they've been using, the conversations they've had with the students? So we really wanted to kind of cover off on that process more widely and really prompt that conversation with the educators throughout the resource. So the resource itself comes with a number of different components. We have a PowerPoint presentation, some session guidelines to guide people through the delivery of that, case studies that you can use, and some activity sheets with particular activities that we've outlined, and a series of supporting resources. And those things kind of make up the kit, and they're all there and downloadable for you on the ADCET website.
Yeah, so there's a PowerPoint presentation that has, I think it was about 40 slides in it. It's what I really love about the kit, and I'll tell you a little bit more when I share my experiences facilitating and using it, is it's just so easy to contextualise and work with. So once you know who your audience is and what you're delivering, you can go through, and you also know what your time frame is and the mode of delivery, you can go through and contextualise this presentation, which I did at the time when I used it. It's a great kit. So it's got a wealth of information there that you can actually have a look at and determine who's my audience, how I'm delivering, and what am I going to use on this specific delivery. So it's a great presentation.
And I think what's really important is we do encourage you to adapt it and contextualise it, because it's really, we just wanted to give people some starting resources, really, because each of our organisations are really different. We have different processes, different ways we use access plans, different templates for access plans, you know, and so we really wanted to provide just with some foundations that you can build on and contextualise to meet your requirements. So we have provided a whole outline of the session as we see it, as a full 2-hour session, but, you know, when not mandating it, and we're not prescribing that that's the way that has to be done, but we just really wanted to give people some guidance around that and how they could be using the tools and resources that we've developed. But we certainly encourage you to think about contextualising those as much as possible.
Thanks, Jen. And yeah, one of the tools that we came up with is this activity sheet, which gives us the opportunity to have a conversation with a practitioner to help identify and document, you know, what are the inherent requirements. So helping them unpack that unit of competency, having a look at what's required as far as the student demonstrating evidence, what are the tasks that they have planned for the student undertaking the unit of competency, and then have a conversation around what the potential reasonable adjustments can be. And it's a really good tool to use, particularly with our beginning teachers that are really getting used to this process, because you can actually map out the conversation and you've got you discussed for the actual teacher to take away with them. So that's just an optional tool. It might be something that you do during your presentation, or it might be something that you can work with outside of that presentation or at any time with your practitioners, or it's just a tool that you can use on an ongoing basis to help you have those conversations when you're doing a consultation with them, and you know, identifying what reasonable adjustments could work with a particular unit of competency. Thanks, Jen.
Thanks, Meredith. And I think it's always important that people are working in a very connected way to the areas that they deliver and assess in. So this really, you know, these types of activities, we haven't prescribed the way they'll be done. We want people to be able to really connect to that themselves. We have provided some general resources as well, a sort of fact sheet about the process of access plans, the purpose, you know, the legal framework. So it just really outlines that whole process, and that we hope will be really helpful for organisations that may not have that well documented yet, but can certainly guide practice. We've got a quick reference guide with links and resources that people can go to if they want to explore more and want to know more. And we created just a really simple glossary of key terms and concepts just to support people's understanding, because we often are assuming that they know and understand a lot about access plans, but that may not yet be something that they've dealt with directly in their own area. So we just wanted to make sure that that was something that was available to people.
Okay. So I'm just going to show you these case studies that we opened. Just bear with me, everyone, as I share my screen. Okay. They're just fabulous. I mean, I read through these case studies. If you can't tell, I am an actual former teacher, so I get a bit overexcited. But we collected 17 different case scenarios, which were written by members of our community of practice. And they're great. They can be contextualised. We set them out so that we would have a student name, and I mean they could be case studies from experience that a student and we've just given them a fictional name. I know the ones I did were from students that I had worked with over time, but we collected them. We've got 17 altogether, and different sort of student demographics and different levels of qualifications. So we've actually got case studies from certificate one up to diploma across a range of vocational backgrounds. If you particularly wanted to contextualise them into a vocational background, you could, you know, you could look at that. So if you were wanting to use some different case studies for one particular delivery area, for example, if you were working with community services and you wanted to contextualise them into that, you could make those changes yourself. What you do with them is up to you, but they're such a great starting point. They have a good profile of the student and identifies the disability that they identify with. We have some of the impacts that disability has on that student, implications for learning, and these implications are relating to the type of course that the student is doing. Okay. And then we've actually added a particular event, so something that's happened in a delivery, you know, classroom context for that student. Then after that, we have some inclusive educator strategies. I'll talk a little bit more about this when I explain how I'm delivering it at my particular organisation. but we've given a really nice collection of strategies that our teachers could use to help, you know, ensure that this student succeeds with and has reasonable adjustments and has that sense of belonging that we are so passionate about working towards. And whether you use these or not is optional. You can use them or you can take them out, but they are there for you. And depending on who you're working with and the level of experience and knowledge that your teachers has will depend on whether you use them as well. So they're wonderful. So that was just one example of Andre. I'll just come out and I will show you another one. So Andre was 20 studying the certificate 2 of bakery, and Andre identifies as deaf and has a cochlear implant. We then had Ravi, who was you know, had a different background there. He came to Australia as an asylum seeker. He gives a little bit of his background as far as where he lives. He's doing a certificate 1 in construction, wanting to be a carpenter, gives some explanation of the activities in his class, and again, impact, implications on learning, an event, and then we've got those strategies there as well. So we've got those lower level pre-vocational qualifications, and then we've got examples such as Sarah, who's doing a diploma of events management, doing a full-time load. And then Taylor, who's a recent school leaver, who's 16 and has enrolled into a certificate 3 in cabinet making. So again, there's an identified disability and the impact. So they are a wonderful set of resources there that that you can use as part of your delivery. So I'll just move on to, I'm going to hand back to you, Jen, now.
Terrific. Thank you, Meredith. And I just want to make a point about that, that there's a real opportunity there. And it's come up in a couple of questions that people submitted regarding, you know, there is a time for people to have an access plan, and that particular things may be dealt with through the access plan. But there are many of our students who haven't disclosed that they have particular requirements. And so having those case studies where it's a little bit broader, and we're talking more about beyond the access plan, what are some of the other things we can do to actually do that and, you know, address those needs without the need for that disclosure from that person is really important as well. And I think that's really one of the nice things, is that we're recognising that having an access plan is one part of it, but a lot of it's about the way we respond as educators and really building our own toolkit around the types of things that we could be doing is really important. And so we thought it might be just valuable, while we've got such an amazing group of people online, to do a little bit of a breakout session. And we've got some prompting questions here, but we're, you know, happy for you to kind of have a little bit of a chat in your group about your experience or what you're observing, maybe some of the challenges around access plans and implementing them effectively, or what some of the challenges might be around you building educator capability around access plans, or perhaps whether your organisation's using some really key strategies to address those things. So we're going to get Jane to assist us to pop everybody into breakout groups. If people need the captioner, you will be allocated to the same group as the captioner at that point in time, so you should appear in the same group. But we'd really like you just to take the next 5 or so minutes, or 10 minutes at the most, to have that conversation with each other, and then to come back and we'll pop some of your key points into the chat box, and Meredith and I will work through those with everybody.
So thanks, Jen and Meredith. It's Darlene here. Just if people, when they get allocated, you just need to click the join button when you get allocated to your group. So just to do that. I think, thank you everybody for bearing with us. We managed to lose 3/4 of our audience in going to a breakout room. Everybody was too scared to work together. It's very disappointing. but so I really thank and commend all those people who stayed with us. Well done. And hopefully you got a bit out of the conversation. So I'll hand back to you, Meredith and Jen.
Thanks very much, Darlene, and thanks, Jane, and thanks, everyone. That was a leap of faith, but clearly is obviously scary for many people. We just wanted to ask, are there any kind of key things that were discussed in your group that you just wanted to pop into the chat box around some of the challenges or the strategies that you might have been using? I know that in the group that I was in, we were certainly talking about the lack of training that educators probably have had in the VET sector around some of these areas. And we've often expected them to be incredibly skilled and capable in doing those types of things. But in reality, they just haven't had that information or training or guidance around how they might be able to do that effectively. Meredith, do you have anything more to add?
I think I get some feedback from everyone, and then I'll go into the example of, because that sort of correlates with what I'm going to talk about with that experience of rolling out the the resources.
There's a message there from Michael. Yeah. Thanks, Michael. I think that's a really good point about disclosure. And if people seek out an access plan, does that actually, you know, create other impacts for them? And I think that's really a key issue that's going to be going on and on around that. And we do need to kind of then, I think, design the way we deliver and assess, the way we engage students, the way we, you know, set up enrolment procedures, all of those things need to take that into account, that people can access that additional support. And I think that was really one of the key reasons why we wanted to put the case studies in, was to show people that beyond an access plan, there are other things we can be doing to effectively support students who may have other issues. Yeah, and sometimes there aren't robust orientations, yes, so people aren't sure of that, and I think that's a great point to understand. Thanks for that, Susan, and I think it's one of the things we talk about, you know, when we're looking and using these resources, you're really kind of trying to encourage people to feel much more confident about identifying and connecting with their student support services or their equity services or the people in your organisation who can help you support those students. I think that's really important as well. And Bianca, you've said that there was a great analogy in your group that it can be hard for students to know what will assist them when studying if they haven't had much exposure to what has worked for them in the past. Yeah, being at a restaurant and being asked what you would like to have without being given a menu, yeah, is a pretty big challenge for us. And I think that's really a fabulous analogy. And I think that is what happens for students. You know, they do often transition from school or other experiences and don't come with that knowledge and understanding about that. And if we then get, you know, if I'm that person and then I get an educator who doesn't really understand how they might be able to respond, you know, then we get into a pretty awkward situation. And I think that's when we often see people drop out of their courses and say that I just didn't get the support or that I needed or have those opportunities. So I think that's fantastic. So thank you, everybody, for starting to look at that. Yeah, it is a really great analogy. And the documents, you know, in the training packages and things really don't give a lot of guidance. They are certainly improving, but they don't give a lot of guidance. And, you know, that lack of collaborative support means that it is always pushed back to the educators to really, you know, manage it. But if we think about what kind of training we might have had or professional learning we've had to develop that, and that's really where sort of our heart lies in having developed these resources. So thanks, everybody. That's wonderful. And your feedback's really fantastic around that. But look, Meredith's going to give us a little bit of information about her experience of actually delivering them, but I just thought I'll just talk about, you know, we feel that having that face-to-face, whether you do that in the same physical environment or online, is an important way to use these resources, because we want people to really connect and have that opportunity to discuss, and that does increase that engagement. I think to date where we've done it with groups, it certainly increased engagement. People feel very relieved, I think, to have some of that conversation, but it also is about that myth busting, kind of help people connect to the right information and processes in their own organisation, perhaps some of their own thinking. It's a great way to do some unpacking of particular issues or examples that groups have, work groups have, around their own qualifications, and having it in small sort of educator groups, you know, we can be sensitive to a range of the issues that are going on, and we can sort of manage that. And we can really build on previous experiences that people have had, whether they're positive or negative, and kind of really help to turn that around. And the fact that we can contextualise these resources really just is what it's about. And Meredith's going to sort of share some of her experience in delivering with her teams.
Thanks, Jen. And thanks everyone for the great comments and feedback. Here that, you know, that it's really good that we're all sharing our, you know, challenges and our concerns. Just having a quick look, I can see Kate has mentioned about the lack of collaborative support and resources in funding-focused private RTOs, you know, pushing it back onto their trainers to manage on their own. You know, these resources are so critical, and, you know, like, I come from a large RTO, I'm TAFE's Queensland. I'm very aware of the challenges that our private RTOs have in that regard, and the wonderful thing about the ADCET resources and our communities of practice is that they are for everyone. And also, I know Bianca mentioned earlier about, you know, it's hard for students to know if they don't really know. We start from, you know, at the first point of contact, we get students coming in at year 10 onwards, and our focus is always about building their awareness and their self advocacy, and working with the schools as they transition into post-educational programs. And having this chance to use this resource with our teachers is enhancing that process, because we're building their understanding and awareness, because they, you know, they also don't know what they don't know. And by having them, you know, get confidence and buy-in, we really are, you know, going to be able to get to a stage where we can create that sense of belonging for our students and for everyone. So my experience, I did write a few notes, so if I'm flicking around a bit, you'll see why. I just wanted to really share it, because, you know, I've got total investment in this being involved, but I also got involved because I knew how valuable this resource and process was going to be to us as equity practitioners and to my organisation and ultimately to my students. So I worked for TAFE Skills Tech, and we are an extremely large Queensland RTO, and we provide training in the traditional trade areas, so the construction and the plumbing and the electro areas. I've got four campuses. I've probably got about 300 plus teachers across there. I was given the opportunity to engage and do a session at our staff PD in January, and that was face to face. So that was wonderfully beneficial. But of course, you know, this can be moved over into other forums, but I had the face-to-face opportunity. So I was given some sites 1 hour, some sites 1.5 hours. So I was able to grab the resource and take out of it what I believed I needed. So my first tip was, tip one was to know who your audience is, all right? I know my trade teachers, I knew my time, I knew what worked for them. Tip two was about building a delivery approach. So when I looked at it, I determined that I wasn't going to just roll out this one-off PD session, all right? This was my starting point, because I knew I could use this and do a lot more to optimise the learning and engagement and development of my educators. So I came up with a four-tier approach in delivering access plans for educators. Again, you know, targeting that sense of confidence and belonging with my staff. So that was my tier one, was having the face-to-face using the contextualised resources. One group I was able to get working on the case studies, but the other groups, I didn't have the time there. So I just parked those case studies because I'm going to be using them later on. So the tier two with my approach is to be going to engaging at their team meetings, be it face-to-face or online. And it's at that point for some of my teams, because my teams are all at different stages of you know, skill level and experience and have different cohorts, I'm going to, for some of them, look at doing some case study work with them. My third tier is around ensuring that all of the staff that I'm working with, all of our educational staff, are undertaking the wonderful disability awareness training that is free on ADCET. Now, I'm targeting the training for the educators, and I'm also going to be targeting my colleagues that are non-educators to do the training for non-educators there. That is just, it's an outstanding resource. I can't compliment enough, and it's free. And it's even got some tracking there, so I can track who's done it, who started it, and who hasn't. Because when I get to stage three, I've really got good engagement with my teacher cohort, right? They've put up with me in my face-to-face. They've engaged with me online or in face-to-face at a team meeting, and I'm now getting them through tier three doing that disability awareness training. My fourth tier is around really starting to build their skills around having student conversation. So it's at that later stage that they'll have more confidence and understanding and awareness of access plans, all right, in an educational context. Now, I'm talking fast, I am sorry, because I'm just conscious of our clock. One of the important, realisations is understanding that our teacher cohort is at different stages in development. And I go back and reflect from, you know, having a teaching background, it's around, the stages of learning, where our truly beginning teachers are coming in and they have unconscious incompetence because they don't know what they need to know. They've got no experience. And that's a prime opportunity from us at that foundation level to start working with them. So if I'm working with those unconscious, incompetent teachers, that it's them that I would really be looking at using those case studies with to the fullest extent, and working through and using those inclusive educator strategies and actually demonstrating it to them, all right, and showcasing. They're great examples there. So we can start really building their understanding and awareness of our students, you know, their needs and the adjustments that they can make to become inclusive and ensure that they, you know, they're comfortable and engaging. The next one is that conscious incompetence level, which is where our staff are aware that they need to know something about access plans and about reasonable adjustment and accommodating students, but they really don't know what it is that they need to know. Okay, and our tool, our resource kit, it's so explanatory. When, you know, Jen took you through earlier on all the content, it's all there for them. So when we know where our teachers are at, we can work through that content there and build on that. So with that group, I would give them a case study to do, but I would give them all of those inclusive educator strategies to reflect on and work in partnership. The next level would be the conscious competence, and that's where our teachers really know, you know, they're quite informed. They know about access plans. They understand about reasonable adjustment, and they have got some experience. So it's at that stage I would possibly take those inclusive strategies out and get them to work either individually or collectively and identify what they have experienced and what they've seen works well with reasonable adjustment for, you know, specific scenarios. And then with that ultimate goal being that our very experienced teachers are, or we're going to, as we work through the PD, through the four tiers, we're going to get our teachers to that stage of unconscious competence, okay, where they are actually so experienced and aware that they are performing and including and ensuring our students have, and our teachers and equity practitioners have, a sense of belonging without actually knowing that they're doing it. So I will be targeting I've done the teachers, I'm doing our client services team, and I'm doing our vet in schools team, and hopefully our business managers, and I'll be running through the resource and contextualising it for them and doing some sessions as well. And the final sort of my four tips is get that consistent language out there and reinforcement with staff. So I am so much more conscious of using the language that's reflected in that resource. I talk at forums, I put little articles and reminders into our staff newsletters as well, and everything I'm doing, I'm linking back to our access plans and our processes so that the teachers are getting more and more exposure and familiarisation. So thanks everyone. I hope I explained that well.
All right, so just 2 more minutes, Jen,
yeah,
and we
sure.
have to wrap up.
I was just going to say that, you know, as you can see, there's lots of different ways to use the resources. We're certainly using it now as part of our complaints resolution, where a complaint might relate to access plans or support provided to a student, continuous improvement through your TAE delivery. So lots of different ways it can be used. And really, just to wrap up, that kind of idea of having a sense of belonging is really what we're trying to create. The importance really of having the conversations, intervening early, and building that partnership between the student services or supports and your educators, and really, you know, empowering our educators to feel confident about supporting students with disability. So thank you very much for your time. It's been great to share the resource with you. And thanks, Jane and Darlene, for your support.
No, that's fantastic. Thank you for delivering such an informative session. I've certainly got a lot out of it. As I said at the beginning, it's very easy to put information up on the website and then not engage. And I think this is really kind of encouraging people to really engage in the content and be able to use it to benefit the students with disabilities and their organisation. So thank you, everybody, for joining us. Thank you for those who managed to stay on and join the groups. And I'm sure Jen and Meredith will be happy to hear from anybody if they've got any
Absolutely.
Questions.
Yep, definitely.
Or was there your contact details at the end or not? No. The last slide? No.
No.
No. All right, but contact
us if
you haven't.
Yeah, they're cool. Up on the website anyway, Darlene, our contact details.
Excellent.
So please, if you want to have a chat or a discussion, please feel free.
Yep. Excellent. All right. Have a great day, everybody.
Terrific. Thanks, everyone.
All right. Bye.
Take care.